just one.
Okay. All right, today, here's what we're going to cover. Okay, here's what we're going to cover. We're going to cover the basic properties about vectors. We're going to do add, subtract. We'll talk about scalar multiplication. We'll do one example of that. Then we have new stuff today. I want to talk about how can we do a vector where it doesn't start on the origin, 0, 0. They call those representing vectors in rectangular coordinates. That's what they call it. So I just put it on the board as rectangular coordinates. We'll talk about that. It's a very easy process. This will explain. I actually need to go through this so we can get to one of our later properties today, if we can get to that point. I don't want to go the entire time, so I'll kind of end when I feel like it's appropriate time. Magnitude, we did that one yesterday. I do want to cover magnitude again. Like that's distance. What is the formula? What's the shortcut? How can we find it? We'll talk about direction today. You know, like the idea of like northwest or northeast, that type of thing. And you know how the angle system works. And then we're gonna introduce, if we have time. And this is the reason why I needed these, is so that we can apply to the new thing, which is called a dot product. I'll explain that once we get there. It will not make sense until we put everything together and you're like, okay, I understand why we have the dot product. Like, there's a certain reason for it. And we'll get to that eventually. And this is actually really, really helpful that we can actually see that. Okay. Questions, comments about what we're going to attempt to get covered today. Now, whatever we don't cover today, we just spill into tomorrow and we'll finish up tomorrow.
Okay.
So I think stuff is pretty straightforward. Remember, this is like the intro section. We still have like another section of this. I'm expecting a test, quiz, whatever you want to call it, next week sometime. We'll do the normal two-day review. The sections will be 6-1, 6-2. This section, 6-7, which is the next section we're going into. And then I think there's a section in chapter 9 that I have to find. I have to find what number it is. But it deals with, this stuff. It deals with the vectors. Question?
The calculators are back?
I do. So we have them all back. One was found in the lost and found bucket out in the hallway.
I'm sure.
So, yeah. Let's not put those in there. Those are mine. Alright. Okay, let's talk about the properties of a vector. Okay? Let's talk about adding and subtracting vectors. So vectors, again, remember, vectors, when they write like the notation-wise, They give it a single letter. It's usually like boldface. It could be a V, it could be a W. They usually put arrows above it for vectors. Sometimes they don't. I've actually seen in your book, they just leave them like boldface. That's fine. It's depending on the author, what their style is. But after these, and it doesn't matter what vectors I have, maybe there's a vector Y, let's say. I could have, three different vectors, so I could have any number I want. I could have, -6, I, plus 2j, right? That's a vector. It has an I component and a j component. The I and the j mean horizontal and vertical distance.
Which one's which again?
I is the x number, that's horizontal, okay. And j is the vertical, so horizontal. And this is vertical. Yeah. Good question. Now the problem is, question? They don't want to use x and y's because we can name the vector x or vector y. It just has a horizontal and vertical input. So, yeah. All right. Now, for my vectors, these can have any numbers. I could just call this, this could be just 4j. I could have a vector just like that. I know that seems weird. It doesn't have an I component because what would the I component be? 0. So they could just write like this, which actually means 0i plus 4j. That'd be the same thing. So they don't need to put, like, if the zeros there, they can kind of just get rid of it. I could have it, 5i minus 10j. They could just be random vectors. Now, how these look if you're putting them together, if I'm adding or subtracting these, you basically just attach one to the other. And you go the direction that the coordinates are kind of telling you. So you have to imagine that, let me put a picture up here. Imagine that we're on a coordinate plane, right? And I want to represent a visual representation of V plus W, where you connect the two vectors together and you add them. Well, what that means is you start with drawing vector V, and let's assume that we start at 0, 0. Okay, so here's 0, 0. Make sure you bring that back. Okay.
Yeah, I'm
the one stealing them. All right. So, okay, so we're gonna draw vector B. Now, vector B, well, let's assume it starts at 0, 0. How would I draw this?
Negative
6
up
2. So negative 6 means the x-axis numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 up 2. This is vector V. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Like the I and j component are just like the x and y numbers basically. They just don't call them x and y's. Call them i's and j's. So that's a vector. Notice I put an arrow. It's going towards negative 6, 2. That's where it's heading towards if we start at 0, 0. Now we're going to add W to it. W is this one, right? So this is W. We're going to be adding. So we're going to start, and I'll put this in a different color so you can kind of see this. We're going to start at this location, right? That's the location. And we're going to go this spot from there, right where the tip of the arrow is. I'm going to go 0 right and left, but I'm going to go positive 4 up. So positive 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is vector W, and that's added on top of V. You just draw the exact same direction that we would normally draw. And so the final answer, like what you're seeing on the board, this thing right here, what you're seeing this, that part is this line right here. This thing right here is V plus W. So the best way I can explain it is imagine that you're flying in like an airplane, right? So you flew to an airport, and then the airport went north and it went this direction, right? And we ended up here. Well, what this is like this is the path you could have taken just to go from where you started directly to where you ended. Like you don't have to go through those terminals, right? You don't have to do, what do they call them when you're on flights?
Layovers,
that's it. That's a good word. All right, so it's a layover, right? I'm avoiding the layover. I'm just going straight right to the destination I want to go. That's what we're doing. We're going V plus W. Question.
Okay, so wouldn't the straight way be shorter?
Yeah, the straight way would be shorter than going that weird random distance, right? The idea is that this representation is the best way to travel instead of going around the block, right?
So then how are the two longer ones added together to equal that?
Because what this represents, this, when you write this, this represents the shortest path to your destination. It's hard to represent this. It's not like we're taking this stick, like the length of it, and adding it to the length of this stick. That's not what we're doing. I'm just saying, like, this thing that you're seeing on the board, that represents the shortest path to where you started to where you ended. Okay? So it's not the situation where I'm taking the actual distances. I'm actually trying to represent, like, the shortest path there. Okay? If that explains a little bit. It's really hard to explain that, actually. Okay, but that's what we're doing. Now, to do this, how you add vectors together, you just add the I and J components. So if I added these together, what do you get? 6i, okay. So this would be negative 6i, because I added the two parts together. And what would the J component be? 6j. That would be a positive 6j. That's this, what you're looking at right here, is the same thing as going from the starting point to where you ended. That is the preferred path that you want to take. Obviously, like Tyler said here, if you went around the block, that would be a longer distance, but we're not doing that. We're not finding distance. Distance, according to vectors, is magnitude. We're not finding magnitude. We're actually trying to find the path you would actually take that would be the same path, that would get you to the same result, the same destination. So it would be a shorter distance, obviously, like you said, but it's the preferred path. Okay. That's the best way to explain it. Okay, questions with that? Okay, now that's adding. If we subtract vectors, let's say I did, let's go like vector W minus vector Y. Let's do that. So I'm going to do a whole new drawing. So we're going to start all the way over, and we're going to do vector W minus Y. So let me get rid of this. Hopefully that made sense to you how I did that. All right, so vector W minus Y. How this works, I need to draw a vector W first. I'm going to start here. We always start on the origin. And I'm going to draw a vector w. So w is the first one. So I'm going 0 right and left. I'm going up 4. So this is vector w. Yeah? That's vector w. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to subtract y. Subtracting y means I'm going the complete opposite direction that y would normally travel. That's what this little minus sign means. That I'm going the opposite direction. So in fact, I'm going to draw what y would actually go towards. And then I'm going to draw it the opposite way. So y, if we actually draw y, it goes 5 to the right, down 10, right? Because that's what this component says, right? That from here, I would go over 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then down 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah. So it would, you know, let me get rid of all these red lines. This would be where y would normally travel. But I wanted the negative y. So negative y would be going this way. That's negative y. That's going the complete opposite direction. Now, how we do that, like the shortcut for doing that, is you just distribute the negative sign through y. So it's like I'm doing this. I'm taking a negative 1 times y, and then I'm going to distribute the negative 1 into that. That's the easiest way to draw a negative y. So you don't have to think about going the opposite. You can just write the numbers down. So I'm going to take a negative 1 times this vector, right? When I do that, you just basically distribute the negative 1 to both parts here and here. So what would these numbers turn out to be? Yeah. Negative 5i plus 10j, right? Because I distribute the negative 1 over both numbers. That is negative y. So that's what you're seeing here. I'm going negative 5 this direction, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then up 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It's actually really close. That's where it ends up at. Because that's the negative. And so what this is, when I actually subtract these, it's actually finding where you started to where you ended, this dotted line. This is what I'm finding. Like, what was the path you could have taken if you didn't do layovers with the airplane? You just went straight shot, straight home. So what we do is we actually just take this vector, this is the negative y vector, and I'm going to add it to the w vector. In fact, I'm going to put that over here. So the w vector is 0i plus 4j. I'm going to add that to the negative y vector. That's negative 5i plus 10j. So this is W's vector, this is negative Y's vector, I'm going to add them together. And what do I get? Yeah, negative 5i's plus 14j. And that would be the vector W minus Y. That would be the path that would get me to the same location. And again, what those numbers are, like when I'm looking at that I and J, that's starting here, what would be the coordinates getting me back home? Negative 5 over 14 up. That's what would get me all the way to that spot. Okay, does that make sense? Like what we're doing? It should be straightforward. I think this is like, when you think about this stuff, it seems easy, right? You're just adding I components, adding J components, or subtracting them. But the trick is you got to distribute negative signs and all that good stuff. The picture is probably the difficult part. Like when you're looking at it, God, it's ugly. But hopefully that makes sense to you. Like you're just taking airplane flights and you're just trying to go home. Okay, now in this problem, in that problem I just did, you added vectors, right? We subtracted vectors, and when you subtract vectors, you actually do a scalar multiplication, where you actually multiply the number onto a vector. That's where you distribute it. So let me walk through one of those. So let's instead of drawing, let's talk about how I can do a scalar multiplication. So let me get rid of this picture. So let's say I wanted to go, somebody just make up a number.
7.
I heard 1,000?
7.
Oh, 7. 7, sorry. All right, so let's say we did 7v. So that's a scalar multiplication. I'm going to take 7 times vector v. So whatever the numbers are for vector v, I'm going to take each number times 7. So it's 7 times the 2j, right? Yeah, you're just distributing the 7. So this number, so 7 times the vector b, this actually turns out to be negative 42i's plus 14j's. And what this actually is, like, when you're looking at that, like, most people, like, they always want to know, like, what is 7V? It's basically the vector V drawn 7 times on top of each other. So, like, where would you end up at? So, vector V, if I were starting here, you know, what we did earlier, we talked about, that's going over negative 6 up 2. This was vector V that we did earlier. It's basically doing 7 as many of those. So, there's 1, 2, and I keep going, and I keep drawing 7 of them. And where would it end up at? It'd end up at negative 42 down the road, up 14. Be way down. Does that make sense, like, what that means when you do scalar multiplication? It's actually 7 times the distance. Okay. Hopefully that makes sense. We'll do probably a little more of those tomorrow. I'll have you try a couple and do some graph paper, and you can try drawing some stuff. We'll do maybe that might be a little more hands-on activity tomorrow. All right. Let's talk about how to do rectangular coordinates. Now, obviously, we've been looking at a graph, right? But what happens when our graphs don't start at 0, 0? Like when a vector doesn't start at 0, 0. And I want to show you how that works. Like, how can we come up with the notation for it? All right. So let's say that my initial point, that means the starting point for my vector. So the initial point is, let's say it's 3, 2. That's my starting point. And let's say the terminal point where it stops, terminal point is 10, negative 1. Let's say that that's where it started and where it stopped. So I'm gonna draw that vector so you can see it. And we'll call this vector, let's call this vector x. Let's call it that, right? So 3, 2. So there's the initial point. The terminal point is 10, negative 1. And so this is the direction it's going. Is this the terminal, this is the initial, right? So the terminal side always has the arrow. That's where I'm going to. I'm stopping that direction. Agreed that it doesn't start on 0, 0. Mm-hmm. Okay. But I need to come up with the components. I want to know, like, what this vector is in terms of i's and j's. So it's called the x vector, but I need some number I, right? And I need some number j for I and j components. And I want to know what that is for my vector here, because it is called vector x. Yeah, exactly. You actually just subtract the two coordinates. So to find the I component, you take the terminal number, and you subtract the initial number. That's how it always works. So for the I component, when I actually subtract those, I get 7 I's. And then for the J component, I just subtract terminal minus the initial. So negative 1 minus 2. Negative 1 minus 2 for the J component. And this turns out to be a negative 3J. So my final vector, like the actual, like, the actual representation, the what they call the rectangular representation of my vector is this. It's 7i minus 3j. Like, that's the easiest way to write that vector. Does that make sense? Like, where we subtract them? And so if I were to actually, like, move this around, that hopefully that would make sense. Like, if I move this vector to be right on 0, 0, to draw the same vector, this one, I would go over 7 down 3. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3. This is the same vector. You can move vectors wherever you want. They're the same vector. It has the same direction, same magnitude. They're actually exactly equal to each other. So you can move vectors wherever you need them. So don't be confused, like, if you want to move a vector right on top of the x, you know, right on top of the origin. You know, moving it, as long as it's going the same direction and it has the same length, you're fine. Because that's all a vector is. If you go back to the definition, it has to have magnitude and direction. So it didn't tell you where to start.
Basically, they're parallel.
Yeah, exactly. They're parallel. That's the best way to think of it. Vectors that are parallel to each other and the exact same length are the exact same vector. There's no difference. So you can put them anywhere you want. Well, yeah, that was a good comment. All right. Okay. Any questions about that stuff? Okay, let's talk about how to find magnitude. Like, how to find the length of that stick. Because obviously we know we can draw different spots. But how to find the length of it? We did talk about that. We did have a formula to help us find to find length, distance. It's called magnitude. Magnitude is represented by this. This is how we find magnitude, or distance. So this is the magnitude formula. Yeah, it's magnitude or length, however you want to think of it. Yeah, we had the formula that we talked about yesterday was you have this big square root, and you're subtracting the x-coordinates, and you're squaring that, and then you're subtracting the y-coordinates, and you're squaring that, and stupid. All right, the shortcut is you just take your I component and your J component, and you square them, you add them together, and take the square root. So I'm going to avoid this whole mess. It's just you take the I component, which in my case is the 7, you square that, you add that to the J component squared, so that's the -3 squared, and you take the square root of it. So if you have your I and J component, it's really easy to figure out length of that stick. Because I already did the dirty work. I already subtracted the x's and the y's. So I don't need to do it again. So this turned out to be 49 plus 9, because the -3 squared is positive. And when I add that together, I get 58. And that number is not 3. So I'll just take the square root of 58. That's the length. Right? Square root of 58 is just below the number 8. It's like 7 point something. 7.8, let's say. Because 64, the square root of 64 is 8, so I know it's not quite 8. Okay, questions, comments about how to find length magnitude? Notice the little double bar, that's the notation we used yesterday, the length of the stick. And that's, I think, Tyler, that's what you were asking about earlier, like when I was drawing those pictures of the airplane slide. I'm not talking about the lengths are the same, I'm talking about where you get to, the destination was the same. So, yeah, there was a difference there. All right, now, magnitude is a big deal, right? We talked about yesterday how to find length. It makes sense, you know, for especially the story problem that we were doing it for that last homework, that page 662. When we were setting up triangles, having the length of the walls was a big deal. So we could set up law of cosine, law of sine, if you have the actual distances along the triangle. But also direction was important for those story problems. You know, knowing what angles, like directional bearing, you needed to take. You know, because I think some of those problems, they said, like, oh, take a path 34 degrees northeast. Okay, so north, you go east 34 degrees. Sometimes that number wasn't even in the triangle, which is fine. But the idea is that having magnitude and direction is what makes a vector. It actually tells you what it is. There's actually a way to write a vector like this completely different. What I mean by that, instead of writing it with like the I and J component, you know, where we just have numbers, we can put it in terms of magnitude and direction. So there's another way, instead of, you know, doing rectangular coordinates, there's a way to show it with magnitude and direction. This is what your book says. This is like the last thing I want to talk about today. How to do this. Okay, in fact, I'm gonna leave this one on the board. This is kind of a good one, right? That I can use this idea of the root 58. In fact, let me get rid of this. We can discuss it. All right.
What do you do with like the camera when you go back there?
What was that?
What do you do with the camera when you go back there? So now it's stopped.
Yeah, but restart. It only has the weird thing about DSLRs like that. Mm-hmm. They only record for about 20 minutes. Then it turns off. So I always start and stuff. Stitch all of them together. Little quirk.
Stitch it.
You
know how to sew it?
What?
You sew it?
Yeah, sew it. Yeah. Alright. Okay. So let's talk about how can we write this in a different way. So if you actually had an angle for a vector, like you knew like on your vector that your vector was going at, let's not draw it that way. Let's say that my vector was tilted at a 30 degree angle, like this. 30 degree angle. You know, from the origin. And you had its magnitude. Let's say the magnitude was square root of 58. Okay? Something like that. I could actually write the vector in terms of that. I could actually put everything I needed to in terms of the angle and the actual magnitude and to get this number here. Because it's just a triangle, if you think about it. It's an actual right triangle. So there is a way to actually come up with the horizontal number. So this is a way to cheat it if you have these numbers. If you have the angle and the magnitude of it. So I could use the horizontal number and I could come up with a vertical number. Because if this is a right triangle, what type of math could we do to it?
Pythagorean
theorem, if we had enough numbers, which we know. Socatelli, the trig functions. If we had enough numbers, we could do Pythagorean theorem. But probably the trig functions. We could actually come up with the x component, the horizontal, and the vertical component. And I could come up with something that looks like this thing, right? If this is what my vector is, right? Let's call this vector, let's give it a different letter. Let's call this vector z. So I don't want to use the same one. So let's call this vector z. We'll do q later. All right, so if I want to come up with the horizontal, the trig function that will help me find that is cosine. Cosine of the angle, cosine of 30, is the adjacent wall, which is the horizontal component, over the hypotenuse, which in our case is the magnitude. It's that root 58. So if you had an angle and you had magnitude, the length, I could figure out the horizontal component because I could just multiply this thing over. And that would be the I component. That would be the horizontal number for my vector. So in this spot here, I could literally write vector z is by doing this. Square root of 58 times the cosine of 30 degrees. And that is my I component, which is the goofiest thing in the world. I know that's weird. But I could literally write it like that. And that would just be a number, by the way, if you had a calculator, right? I could take square root of 58 times cosine of 30, boom, pumps out a number, whatever that is. And then the j component, same thing. The j component is the vertical, so I would probably use the sine function on that one. So the sine of 30 is equal to the vertical distance over the hypotenuse, which is square root of 58. So I can multiply this thing across. And that would be the vertical distance. So that would be this j component. So square root of 58 times the sine of 30. And that would be my j component. So there is a way to cheat this. So if you had angles and you had lengths of walls, there is a way to actually figure out what your actual coordinates are, where you're actually ending up at, which is actually this. That was just something I saw in the book. I thought it was kind of interesting. That there was just a completely different approach. You didn't always have to have a number given for I or a number given for J. If you're given angles and magnitude, you can just jump right into it. I think the way the book writes this, it's really goofy. They write it like this. Magnitude of Z times the cosine of your angle, or the I component. Magnitude of Z times the sine of your angle. And that would be your J component. And that would be vector Z. So, and again, I believe they say that that's a representation of a vector using magnitude and direction. We had magnitude, that's length, and direction is the angle that we're taking to get there. And magnitude would always be in terms of from x-axis up. So you have to think about normal angles, type of thing, like I'm drawing here. Not directional bearing in this case. Directional bearing north is zero, and then you spin around. We'll talk about more directional bearing stuff later, and that will apply more to our homework and stuff.
Good stopping point?
Yeah, I'll stop there.
Good.
Okay, we'll do direct. We'll do that part. That's good.
Can we
get
a thing?
I don't know. If we do, I don't know. If we will, so.
Can I finish the work for the day? Finish the work for the day.
Huh?
Am I gonna work?
Is that?
I'm gonna get out.
I think we're out in 2 or 3 minutes.
Yeah, you got 13.
So we got about 2 or 3 minutes. It's a good stopping point. We already went through a lot of those.
I watched the news.
What's the big news story today?
We did that speech.
Yeah.
What?
What time did that Migo show
last night? Big news story. We ended right at
9. I just heard running. I was in another class and heard the walls.
Yeah, we had 2 classes and we had JV teams running too, so I'm okay.
JV too.
Mm-hmm.
So, is it okay?
So, where were you last night?
Yeah, it was, there was, in 800, there was 5 eats. In the 1500, there was 2 eats.
You had 2 teams that you were supposed to work for.
3,000, there was 1.
I was there for the hurdles.
16
hurdles.
Don't tell me I wasn't involved.
Yeah, so that, we could have been done at 8 if we didn't have JV running.
Yeah.
With, you know, 5 eats of bulk.
I'm sorry, guys. Next time, John Grabs.
We had some good times though.
I mean, we came in
third in our class, which wasn't bad. We're only off by 4 points. Yeah, we got third.
Eight.
No, we actually scored a lot of points.
Yeah,
the one that surprised me the most was.
All of us and go.
Well, I think it didn't surprise me, but we had a couple good runners for I think the 1500. I think we got like second. I think Jillian scored in the. I think she was first in the 400 hurdles. I think.
She was?
Yeah, I think so. If I remember right. We had some good runners, good stuff. I was really impressed with the hurdle team that we had, the shuttle hurdle team. Mara had great form, and then Rachel Haley was surprisingly good at that.
She was
fast. She was like really good. She actually made up the difference because we slowed down in our second runner. I don't know who it was, but she made up like all the distance back. I was actually really surprised by that because I didn't expect that. She was super fast at hurdling.
That's surprising.
Yeah, she was good at it. She had good form.
She's that long one.
Yeah, maybe that's it. She's
like Jumbo, you just
yeah,
like
she didn't have to jump
cold
anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So where did you guys practice last night? You guys practice out here?
Oh.
I was worried when I left. I'm like, God, I just stumbled back in here. It doesn't feel like you guys are watching game film.
Yeah.
I'm in the press box and can't hold it.
Wait, she won her heat or she got first?
Everybody's so quiet today.
What was the big news story today there, Jack?
No, I heard it through the walls.
Oh.
They were watching it, and I was just seeing if it was our class on. That was awful.
Good idea.
I don't know, there might be some big
I don't know, and then after we talked about some guy got, like, murdered someone on Facebook Live.
Oh, yeah.
And then some guy hung himself.
I think some guy last night, that's no. Eric said it.
Oh, yeah, some guy shot
him. More than what's going to happen on the Pacific right now.
Or Aaron Hernandez.
Yeah,
hung himself in his jail cell. He did?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Did he actually succeed at it?
Yeah,
he hung from the window.
Well, he was found innocent of the murder of the 2 people, you know? But he still had a certain life sentence.
How does that work?
What did you
Hernandez. The guy.
Maybe he's going to be charged.